This is a very interesting example because we will see something strange. Of course, we will see also how to work around this issue. Now, as always, to solve an example, I start by substituting all supports with their reactions. Here I have RAY, RAX, and RBY. This would be my free body diagram, of course implying that the supports are not there, only the reactions. However, before I can start working out the support reactions, I need to also calculate the resultant of the uniformly distributed load over here. It is a rectangular uniformly distributed load, so its resultant will be a point load in the mid span, so something like that, and its magnitude will be the area of this shape, or W times the span over which it applies, so W times L. Please keep in mind that this is a resultant force. In other words, this does not substitute 100% the UDL. For example, there is no point of interest over here, typically. However, in this case, we will see that we will need to perform one section over there. As I said, this is an interesting example, and this is actually an exception. So this is not the rule. Nevertheless, let's go to calculate the support reactions right now. So we can see that if we start with the sum of moments about any point, and we can take the sum of moments about point A, which has to be equal to zero, it is possible to calculate one unknown variable, which is the support reaction at point B. So let me say that the counterclockwise moments are positive. This means that WL, which is the load over there, times the distance from point A, which is, well, since it is in the mid span, this will be L over 2. So times L over 2. It is a clockwise moment, so it will get a negative sign, minus WL times L over 2, plus RBY times L, because it is a counterclockwise moment, has to be equal to 0. So if I solve for RBY, I will see that this is WL over 2. Now I can go to the sum of forces in y direction, which has to be equal to 0. I will assume that the ones pointing upwards are positive, so RAY minus WL plus RBY, which I already know, so I will substitute it right now, plus WL over 2 equals 0. So if I solve for RAY, this is WL over 2 also. Finally, I go to the sum of forces in x direction, which has to be equal to 0. If the ones pointing to the right are positive, RAX has to be equal to 0 because I do not have any other horizontal force in my free body diagram. So now I have calculated all support reactions and I'm ready to start calculating internal forces. At this point, I need to define the points of interest. So here I can see two points of interest, one a bit to the right from A and one a bit to the left from B. I have a uniformly distributed load, So I would have two points of interest, one at the left end and one at the right end of the uniformly distributed load. However, it happens that these points coincide with the ends of the beam, so I only have two points of interest in my example. So, section a bit to the right from A. I will keep the left part of the beam. I will substitute the right part with the internal forces. So the internal forces will look like that. NA SA MA. Don't forget the support reactions. The horizontal one is zero, so I don't have to draw it over here. The vertical one is WL over 2. So if I apply the equations of equilibrium, I can calculate the internal forces. The sum of forces in x direction has to be equal to 0. So if I assume that the ones pointing to the right are positive, NA has to be equal to 0. The sum of forces in y direction also has to be equal to 0. So if I assume that the ones pointing downwards are positive, SA minus WL over 2 has to be equal to 0, or SA equals WL over 2. And the sum of moments about any point, but of course it has to be point A, because that's the only point I have in my sketch over here, has to be equal to 0. So if I assume that the counterclockwise moments are positive, MA is the only moment over here, so it has to be equal to 0. The distances are 0, so all the forces are have no moment. I have performed this section over here. I can perform a section over here as well. So, section a bit to the left from B. Now I can see that the right part is the much smaller one, so it is certainly more convenient to keep this one and substitute the left part with the internal forces. So here I draw the internal forces, NB, SB, MB. Don't forget the support reaction. It is a very common mistake. So WL over 2. And of course, this is point B. So now I can apply the equations of equilibrium and calculate the internal forces. Let me start with the sum of forces in x direction. It has to be equal to 0. The ones pointing to the left are the positive ones. So NB has to be equal to 0, since this is the only horizontal force. The sum of forces in y direction has to be equal to 0. The ones pointing upwards are positive because my unknown variable points upwards, so it is more convenient. Even if I would select the other direction, I should get exactly the same result. So SB plus WL over 2 has to be equal to 0, or SB has to be equal to WL over 2. Finally, the sum of moments about point B has to be equal to 0. The only moment I have is MB, which is a clockwise, and that's why I also take the clockwise moments as positive. So MB has to be equal to 0. Now, at this point, I am ready to draw the internal forces diagrams, because I have the internal forces at all points of interest. So let's see how this will work out for me. Now, here I will be drawing the bending moments. Here I will be drawing the shear forces, and I already know that the axial forces are zero all over, so I will just draw it over here for visualization purposes. Typically, I prefer to have all of them on the same column, one below the other. So this will be my axial forces. These will be my moments, and these will be my shear forces. Let me just repeat that because I do not have any values, there are no units to use. However, if there was an example or a question in the test with units, you should add the units at least next to the titles instead of the whole graph. Now, the bending moments on my beam at both points of interest are zero. So it's one over here and one over here. Let's leave it for now and we'll come back to that. The shear forces are WL over 2 over here at point A and minus WL over 2 at point B. Because on the beam I only have point loads or rectangular uniformly distributed load, for the shears I can just connect the points with a straight line. So in this case my graph will look something like that. Typically I should show which part of the graph is positive, which is negative, and I do it over here. So these are my shears. Now let's discuss a bit about the moments. I see that the moments at both points of interest are zero. So one might say, well, you know what? Okay, the moments all over will be zero. However, this is not the case. This is not the case because I can see that I have loads vertical to the axis of the beam. Since I have loads vertical to the axis of the beam, it means that at some points over here, I will definitely have moments. This is not the case with the axial forces because I don't see any forces horizontally on the beam. Now, I know that there are moments, however, the moments at the ends are zero. So how can I address this issue? Well, since this beam is symmetric, it means that if I see the free body diagram, well, I don't have a horizontal component, so I only have two forces at these ends and a UDL all over the beam. And also the shape of the beam is symmetric, it's just a straight line. This means that whatever I have on this side, I should get on this side as well. Now, I know that the moments at the ends are zero, so most probably, as I go further from the ends, the moments will increase or perhaps decrease. I'm not sure if they will become positive or negative unless I solve for them. So what I will do in order to draw the free body diagram is to perform another section directly in the mid span. Let me call it point C. So this distance will be L over 2. I do this because, as I said, the beam is symmetrical about an axis in its mid-span, so I would expect here to get the maximum value of the bending moment, of course, if there is any. In this case, I do know that there is a moment. So, if I perform a section over here, let me just draw the free body diagram here on the right. It will look like that. So, the bending moments will be counterclockwise, MC. Here I will have the support reaction, which is WL over 2, but all over the beam I will have a UDL. Let me just draw it like that. which is W. So now, to calculate the moments, I need to calculate the resultant of the UDL, and the resultant of the UDL will be W times the span over which it applies, which is L over 2. So the resultant will be W L over 2. And of course, the distance from point C will be half the span, or L over 4. So now I can apply the sum of moments about point C, and this is what I will be doing. So if I get the sum of moments about point C, which has to be equal to 0 as always, I see that the unknown variable is counterclockwise. So MC, counterclockwise about point C, I have a clockwise moment from the support reaction, so minus WL over 2 times the distance from point C, which is L over 2. I also have the resultant force over here, which tends to rotate it counterclockwise, so it will give me a positive moment, plus WL over 2 times the distance, which is L over 4, and all of that has to be equal to 0. So if I solve for MC, I can see that this will give me a moment of WL squared over 8. And this will be the moment here in the midspan, WL squared over 8. Now, I have a uniformly distributed load, so regardless of the shape of the UDL for the moments, it will be a curved line. It should look something like that. So it is practically as if it is sagging, because the UDL points downwards. So this is positive. We said that we draw the positive moments below the axis, and this will be my internal force diagram for the moments. As I said, typically the points of interest are the ones we have already mentioned. However, here it was an exceptional case because we had to perform another section to calculate the moments. If you want, you can actually calculate the shear forces and the axial forces a bit to the right and a bit to the left from C, or perhaps directly on point C. It is exactly the same. And check with the internal force diagrams if you get the same values. Here, at point C, in this case, the shear force will have to be zero, because, well, we can see that the moment gets the maximum value, as we will be discussing later on. So if you get a zero shear force, it should confirm your working.